Dear viewers and students, it is chapter 7 of Sidhwa's novel, Ice Candy Man, today. Actually, this is the only chapter which was left without getting explained in the previous recording. So that is why today I thought of completing this novel by recording my commentaries on chapter 7. Chapter 7 begins with the description of Imam Din. And actually, the whole of the chapter is dedicated to Imam Din. How or what type of appearance he has, and up to what extent his dealings are related to the people, and then the place where from he comes and his behaviors at the home of these Parsi people. In that way, Imam Din's entry and his description of the village becomes a very different point in the novel, because this part of the novel is the type of preparation that later on we may be able to listen to the story of one boy, Rana, who belongs to Imam Din and who is the resident of the village of Imam Din. Later on, we may be able to have a long story associated with him with respect to the partition plans and the migrations of the people and the many other type of problems and atrocities and cruelties associated with that migration. So that is why this chapter 7 is written in order to provide us a platform and a type of introduction to the story of Rana. The very first paragraph that begins with says, Aya calls Imam Din the catcher in the kitchen. He sits in a corner on a wicker stool near the open pantry door and grabs anything soft that enters the kitchen. Sitting at him or her on his lap, he gently rocks Aya, I, Adi, Papu. So Trace, Hens, Pups, Kittens, Rosie and Peter from next door have all our turn. Rosie and I are bewildered by Imam Din's behavior. Adi and Peter, belonging perhaps to the same species, are less confused and more aggressive. These lines go to show that how Imam Din was popular among the children and how he was trying to play with these children. We cannot call Aya to be a child. However, Lenny, Rosie, Peter, all other people are children, and Imam Din would catch any of these people who would try to enter into the kitchen and then made them sit in his lap and rocked them also and showed his kindness and love to them. But I definitely was not happy with that. However, the children were happy. Not only the children, but also the animals like cats or the pups, whoever would come, Imam Din would give a rock to that person. So that is why the writer says that Aya called Imam Din a catcher in the kitchen, that all the time he would catch anybody who would go into the kitchen and would make them rock in his lap also. So that is the kind of dealing that Imam Din has with these people. And so it's a thing which introduces as a good person in the description of the story of the novel, which is otherwise having many painful aspects of the novel. Let's go deep and find more things in that which are happening. For example, here, Imam Din possesses a sixth sense, a sensitive antenna that beams him a chart of our movements, and no matter how stealthily Aya or I sneak into the kitchen, he's ready to pounce. He knows exactly who it is, and he never pounces on Mother Yusuf or Hari or us if we are followed by any of them. Imam Din is tolerated because of the gray bristles in his closely cropped hair. They permit him to get away with liberties that in the younger man would provoke, if not the wrath of God, at least dire consequences from Aya, as it is God looks the other way and Aya merely pulls away from him, saying, have you no shame? Look at your gray hairs, fear God. At least Imam Din is tall, big belly, barrel-chested, robust. He bicycles 20 miles to and from his village once a month to impregnate his fourth wife. Happily, he is three times widowed and four times wed. He's the most respected elder in his village, and his benign temperament and wisdom have earned him a position of respect in our house and among the other servants on Wars Road. He's 65 years old. Now you see why he is allowed a certain latitude, indulge even, you might say. So these continuity of three or four small paragraphs even go to reveal the special position that Imam Din enjoyed. This special position of Imam Din was because he was an old person, at least 65 years old person, and so had some gray hair as well. So in that way, if he would catch Aya sometime as well, he would not be abused at all. Rather, Ayah would simply say that, have you no shame at all? You are a very old person, even then you are doing these things. So in this way, certain liberties came to Imam Din when he was an old person. But Imam Din was very sensible man also, that he would catch only the people he wanted to catch, and the people who could react, he didn't catch them at all. So that is why Imam Din was a character who was much related to Aya, much related to Lenny, and much related to any other part of the house. Alongside that, we have the information that not only he's old, but also he's tall, big-bellied and barrel-chested, robust, a strong type of man, and he was able to use his bicycle, drive his bicycle himself 20 miles once a month. So it goes to show that he was not a weak person, even when he was 65 years old, and humorously speaking, he had completed the number of four wives himself, as well as most of the time Muslims are blamed that they would like to have four wives. This person, Imam Din, had four wives after the death of his three wives. He was the husband to the fourth wife. And in that way, he was allowed certain liberties because of the respect he enjoyed because of his old age, the respect among the family members, but also the respect among the Lenny's parents, the respect among the other servants of the house as well. So in that way, Imam Din was a type of leader among the household servants. And the same way, if we continue down to the lane, we shall see that another green area of the lines there. But Aya is in a determined mood. Will you take her with you or not? She demands tongs in her hand, and Imam Din capitulates. Are Baba, you are a Hitler. I shall take her, even though my back snaps into two, even though my legs fall off, I shall take her. She weighs less than this pulka, says Aya, turning her back on us and tossing a thin disc of wheat on the fire until it is swollen with trapped air. So this is the dialogue that again takes place between Aya and Imam Din. Imam Din was going to his village on his monthly tour, and Aya wanted that Lenny should go with him, and he was refusing. Now at this moment, Aya puts him a question, would you take her or not? And Imam Din has to say yes, declaring Aya to be the Hitler. It goes to show how much he was influenced by Aya and how much he wanted to have his good mind with Aya. And Aya praises him by saying that you have agreed and you don't need to worry about the weight of this Lenny, because she was as small, as weightless as the pulka or the dry bread cooked by us people on hard plate maybe. So in that way, the preparation is being made that Lenny should go to a village, and there she should meet certain people to whom she will later on meet after the partition takes place. And in that way, a type of connection may be established between that village partition and Lenny's residence where she was living at that time. So Lenny is now ready to go there, and early in the morning, Imam Din takes Lenny and they ride on the bicycle, and therefore they are able to go by riding the bicycle. As it is the early morning, so that is why it is possible for Lenny and Imam Din to see many people, relieving themselves of the refuse of their foods at the time of morning. They were sitting here and there, squatting here and there, and in that way many bottoms could be seen by Imam Din and Lenny as well. So that's an insignificant part of the text, so that is why I'm not stopping here. It was just meant to give us a type of view of life, and secondly, it was meant to give us the timing, that what is the timing when the ride of the bicycle had begun. Same was the case with the buildings which were present there. For example, Data Sahib Shrine, which came on the way, and after that Badshahi Marsh, Ravi Parade, all these things, and other areas of the Pakistan were mentioned there in order to give a color of the localness or locality from where they were passing, and in order to give us the idea where the scene of events is taking place at this moment. And same is the case with the mention of certain Pathans who would come to Lahore in order to earn their bread from there, and so they too would be seen here and there, and the way how to disappear and wash or not wash, this has also been pointed out. This is an unimportant part, only we will be given a description of one Pathan, one Khan, from the hilly areas he will be given, and we will be talking about him. But so far, only the introductions are being given, who one is and why one is present there. As for example, in the small paragraph, Sherbat Khan is talked about. This Sherbat Khan will be playing a major role in the life of Aya later on. So that is why the ground is being prepared, not only for Aya, but also for other people in partition of Lahore as well. So let's go down and see what further things happen. Rana stops short, peering at us out of small white set eyes. He bends to scrap some clay from the track and throws it at the dogs. Shooing them away, he approaches us gingerly, awkwardly. He's a little taller than me. His skin is almost black in the dusk. He already has small muscles on his arms and shoulders, a well-proportioned body. But what attracts me most is his belly button. It protrudes an inch from his stomach like a truncated and cheeky finger. Later, when he sees me walk, I can tell he's equally taken by my limb. So as we see that Lenny is a narrator, is a very clever narrator, and is able to show the power of observation. Same is the case here, that when Imam Deen and Lenny reached the village, Peer Pindu, at that time she was greeted and welcomed by one boy whose name has been given here as Rana. This boy was just equal to her age, but he was not that neat and clean as it should be. Like Lenny, he was a village boy, so that's why up to some extent he was blackish and was having a different quality of body in him, but he was young at that time. Already he was showing the signs of youth in him. And besides that, a singular one quality of Rana is that with which he may be remembered, that he got the belly button, which was at least 1 inch long from his belly. And Lenny says that she was much fascinated with this thing. And she was also happy that Rana was copying her style of walking, limping style. In this way, the bondage is established between Rana and Lenny, and Lenny is able to comfortably feel there, to find a new friend there whose name was Rana at that time. Rana stares at me, his mouth slack, his teeth are very white and little crowded. Haven't you seen a city girl before? Imam Deen grabs Rana's head lightly. Rana flinches. Why aren't you wearing a shirt? Oh, a shameless bugger. Go tell your mother, we are here, we want supper. Tell Dost Muhammad, we are here. Both Dost Muhammad and Shida are Imam Deen's grandchildren. Muslim communities like to keep the girls in the family, so marriages between first cousins are common. Three, four things which are important in this part of the text is that there are two more characters. One is Dost Muhammad and the other one is Shida. All these people belong to Imam Deen. Some are nephews, some are, you know, grandsons, and in that way Imam Deen is going to enjoy a perfect kind of position and authority upon those people. So that is why he's asking Rana to let other people know and let the mom know that some food is needed, and that's why the food should be prepared. So we are given introduction to not simply Rana, but also introduction to Dost Muhammad, Shida, and the girls of the family who are to stay at the same family in case they are married, because Muslim families would like to keep their girls inside. This is the small thing pointed out, not so important in that way. Next passage is now expanding our vision from Rana to other things. For example, it says that the next morning Rana and I romp in the fields, and Rana fascinated copies my limp. I know that this is unimportant because we know that limping is the characteristics of Lenny, and Rana is copying the same thing. His sisters Khatija and Parveen, barely 2 or 3 years older than us, already wear the responsible expression of much older women. Like the other girls in the village, they affect the mannerism and tone of their mother and elders. They are pretty girls with large serene eyes and the skin inclined to flush. Painfully shy of me, they are distressed and perplexed by the display of my twig-like legs beneath my short dress. I don't wear my calipers as much now. They don't know what to make of my cropped hair either. Busy with chores, baskets of grain stuck to their tiny hips, they scuttle about importantly. And there are two girls more are introduced. One is Khatija and Parveen. So number of children are present in this book, which are very important for the story, because later on these very children will be shown suffering because of partition, and Lenny is able to have a good friendship with them. Though Lenny is very much different from these girls, who are shy, who are who are having different types of manners and tones, who are showing maturity also, and who are showing that they are busy and doing the work at home also. So that way the difference has been created between a city girl as Lenny is and the village girls as Khadija and Parveen are. So Lenny's world is expanding because she is able to meet here Khadija and Parveen, Dost Muhammad, Shida and Rana as well. Let's see further. Later on in the blood winter afternoon, a bunch of bearded Sikh peasants, their long hair wrapped in loose turbans or in form displayed on top knots, visit Pir Pindu. They are from Dera Tik Singh, a neighboring village. The men of Pir Pindu, those who are not out working the fields, come from their barns and courtyard and sit with the Sikhs in a thick circle beneath a huge shisham in a patch of wild grass. The pre-partition situation of the villages of Punjab is being pointed out, that the people, maybe Hindus or Muslims or Sikhs, they used to live together, and if not live together, they would at least share their feeling by visiting the villages of each other. As the political issue and the partition time is coming up, so that is why number of Sikhs are meeting Muslims and Muslims are meeting Sikhs and Hindus, and everybody is worried what is going to happen. And the start therefore in this chapter has been taken, that the Sikhs come to share their feelings under a big shisham tree. They sit with the Muslims of that village, but the very Sikhs will turn violent later on and they would be attacking the Muslims and killing the Muslims as well. So in this way, a hint is being given about the very volatile political situation which will develop at the time of partition, and Sikhs would become the tools in developing this situation, and they would become and noted in history as the people who made maximum injustices with their neighbors and friends at that time when the partition was taking place. And in that way, the village, as it was comprising of the Sikhs and other people also, that is being noted here. This paragraph also is of the same nature. The Sikh Granthi, gray-bearded and benign, beckons the girls and sly-eyes Lord. They come to him. He strokes their covered heads and says in Punjabi, "May the true Guru bless you with long lives." He draws them to him affectionately. "Every time I see you, you appear to have grown taller. We all have to think about arranging your marriage soon." He leans across me and addresses Dost Muhammad, "Don't you think it's time their hands were painted yellow?" So very interestingly, the feelings and the love with the young girls of the household are being shared here, that even a Sikh who would come to visit the house of a Punjabi Muslim, they would say that they are their daughters and they would like to participate in their marriage and they would like to arrange their marriages as soon as possible. So that is to show how much deeply bonded the society was, even if different types of people lived in Punjab at that time. The partition had not taken place, so the people were in love with each other and shared the feelings of love of each other. And that's why the Sikh Granthi, the Sikh religious scholar, is showing a type of love for the girls and trying to show his affection as well, and trying to show his concern also, that he would like to make the arrangement of marriages of these girls. So that was the type of bond of love existed. But happened to this bond in 1947, when partition took place, is a strange question. How human beings can turn from deeply loving to deeply hating type of people, and that possibly in case of 1947, and the politics responsible for that. So in that way, the stage is being prepared, how Sikhs, who were the brothers of the Muslims, would turn into something very enmical for the Muslims as well. For example, a hint is also further provided in this paragraph, which says, "We have eaten and belched. The hookah stoked with fresh tobacco is being passed from among the Muslim villagers. Sikhs don't smoke in the seated lal. The village mullah clears his throat. My brothers," he says, and as our eyes turn to him, running frail fingers through his silky white beard, he says, "I hear there's a trouble in the cities. Hindus are being murdered in Bengal, Muslims in Bihar. It's strange the English Sarkar can't seem to do anything about it." So this is the very paragraph which prepares the all ground and jumps from the tranquil and cool situation to the problematic and volatile situation. And that is according to the religious leader of the village, that certain things bad are happening, that the Hindus are killing Muslims and killing Muslims are killing Hindus, and the English government is not doing anything. So this is the hint that killing and death will take place ultimately in the same village where Hindus, Sikhs and Muslims were living together. So at the end of the chapter, we have the inclusion of that political matter and an introduction to what volatile situation will follow later on. And in that way, the chapter continues to reach its end. And ultimately, Imam Din is addressed by the people when he is said in this paragraph, Bademiya says the Chaudhary, giving Imam Din his due as a respected elder. I am alert to what's happening. I have a radio, but our relationships with Hindus are bound to be strong ties. The city folk can afford to fight. We can. We are dependent on each other, bound by our toil, by mandi prices set by the Paniyas. They are our common enemy. Those city Hindus to us villagers, what does it matter if a peasant is a Hindu or a Muslim or a Sikh? So in that way, peasantry basically is the bond between Muslims and Hindus and Sikhs also. And because of this bond, they think themselves bound with each other. They say that they can face the city people. City people can fight with each other, but the villagers cannot fight. How ironic this statement will prove just after a few chapters, where in 1947 we will witness the scenes of murder and killing and atrocities and bloodshed. At that time, when partition will take place, Muslims will be killed by the Sikhs in the same village, and possibly the Sikhs would accuse the Muslims of killing them. So in this way, everything will be topsy-turvied because of this 1947 partition, as is being mentioned by Sidhwa in her novel. So we see that ironic situation is being developed, that what is being claimed to be right, to be good for the people, will turn ultimately to be bad for the people as well. So in this way, the chapter reaches its close and ends in a very serene note that the things are going to be bad, but however, they will try to make it as good as possible. And Lenny, after having a witness of all this chapter, comes back to her home by riding the bicycle with Imam Din. So the two words are in this novel, shown in this novel. One word is that of the city people, other word is that of the village people. The village people, though, claim to have more and more love for each other, but that claim is totally shaken, it totally broken at that time when it is not possible for the people to live in harmony with each other because of the political aspect of the novel. So in this way, Sidhwa has kept with her narrative, not only the narrative of the Parsi people, but also the narrative of other people who belong to India at that time and now to Pakistan. In that way, this novel becomes a true Pakistani novel, and it also, because it has the history, it also becomes the Pakistani post-colonial novel, because it talks about the colonization and the division and partition of India into two countries because of the English rule and because of the struggle of Indians and Hindus who would like to get the freedom from these people. So in this way, history is being shown and being repeated in order to show what worse condition could develop if the people were not sane, if the people were not good, and if the political elements were not showing their wisdom and sagacity. And here the chapter ends. Thank you very much for watching all that. I hope that most of you have got certain good things out of this chapter. And if you feel like, go ahead and hit the subscribe button to my channel also. Thank you very much. And that's it from me for this day.